Father, move this mortal man to the side and have your way with us. Do something, share something in this moment to help nurture our souls and navigate our lives so that all that we do, all that we feel, and all that we say will be more in harmony with your word, your will, and your way. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I ask you, Lord, beloved, to take the next few minutes as we prepare ourselves for communion and pray with me and for me as we deal with the subject, forgiving the faithful. Forgiving the faithful. I remember visiting someone who was finding themselves in a very low point in their life. And I remember them saying to me, Pastor, I have fallen so short. I want to be faithful, but I don't know how to get there. And I remember telling him, do you remember the Wizard of Oz? And he just looked at me and said, what? And I said, do you remember the Wizard of Oz? It took a long time to find the wizard, but what did they start off doing? And he just laughed and said, they said, follow the yellow brick road. That's exactly. And the moment they stepped on that first golden brick, their journey began. It wasn't after they had gone through the aisles of temptation. It was not after someone figured out what to do to get a brain or a heart or forgiveness or grace. The very moment they stepped on that path, they were on their way to see the wisdom. Faithfulness is not the arrival. It is the journey. And when we find ourselves in a place where we think, Lord, this is not where I need to be. Where am I? Where should I go? How do I get there? We are being faithful the moment we say, Lord, help me to walk from this step forward in your footsteps. At that moment, we start being faithful. And because we are faithful, it takes us in the footsteps of Jesus. And then as he says to us, Lord, help them follow me so that everywhere I go, they will go also. All of us need forgiveness. God's word tells us that all fall short of the glory of God. And the truth is, many of us are dealing with some fault, some fear, some failure in our lives that we know we keep trying to bury it. But in truth be told, that fear, that failure seems to resurrect itself and haunting us. But we try to leave it. There are some mistakes that we make that just keep coming back. But there is a great truth that I want to share with you this morning. And that truth is, our failures don't have to be final. Our failures don't have to be final. And if we want to move past and not stop being haunted by or holding on to our past fears and failures, then we must seek and accept God's forgiveness. That sounds like such a simple thing, accept God's forgiveness. But I know even on a human level, I have watched individuals where someone hurt someone they cared about, and when the one they cared about said, it's okay, I forgive you. I've seen that person turn and go, no, I can't even accept your forgiveness. I can't believe what I did to you. And they shake their head, and even though forgiveness has been offered, they have a hard time accepting it. And if we have a hard time accepting forgiveness from someone that we see every day, how do we forgive, accept the forgiveness of one that is there in spirit, but one that we do not see physically in front of us every day? But it's almost impossible, you see, to seek and accept God's forgiveness if we keep feeling haunted by past feelings or shame. It's almost impossible to seek or accept God's forgiveness if we keep feeling haunted and affected by sins that remain. It's almost impossible to seek and accept God's forgiveness if we're feeling haunted because God's love is not being sustained. Perhaps you've been there. Perhaps you've experienced what that feels like, to know you want to say, I'm sorry, but the feeling of feel driven by feelings of fear and feelings of failure, we need to be aware and beware that God's forgiveness may feel like it's failed when we keep feeling the shame. Keep that in mind. Even though God is there to forgive us, and we know He's there to forgive us because the Word says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. But it's almost impossible to truly accept God's forgiveness if we keep feeling that sense of shame. I remember reading a story of memoirs about a medical foreign missionary who was in a third world country. And what had happened is that there was a small village, and a father felt devastated because his children became sick. And he did everything he could. His wife did everything she could. But whatever they were suffering from, they couldn't identify it. They kept getting worse. And one of the children got so sick, it led to a slow and devastating death. And so the father was told about a medical missionary who was in a nearby village, and he wanted to save the rest of the children, and so he went to that missionary, asking for help, and admitting that there was nothing else that he knew to do, and nothing that the other villagers would do. And he went there looking for him to find out what the missionary could. And his feelings of guilt and grief would not cease. He kept asking himself, what did I do? Is it my fault? Could I have done something more? He was not in the frame of mind to accept God's forgiveness. I don't know about you, but that scenario seriously sounds like the same response and relationship that many of us have with God. Even today, for first we deal with the problems and do all that we know how to do. And then we ask others for help, just to discover what they would or would not do. And then after we've gotten ourselves into more than we can handle, we seek out Christ, the great physician, to see if there's anything that He can do. But it doesn't have to stay there. But for things to change, we need to realize and recognize the first point. God removes our remorse if we seek a new start. God, He will. God will remove the remorse. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. He will remove that remorse if we seek a new start. Oh, that I could start again. For our text tells us in the fourth verse, we hear David pray, against you, and you alone, I have sinned. That's his prayer to God. But then he prays in verse 7, purify me. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. In other words, we must not just pray to recognize our sins. We need to pray to rectify our sins. We should not just say, Lord, I recognize what I have done, but we need to say, Lord, help me stop, help me remove and rectify what I have done. The late baseball legend, Gil Hodges, who was the manager of the Washington Senators, told a true story where he had discovered that four of his players had broken curfew the previous night. And immediately he had a team meeting, and he said to everyone there, I know who you are. I know who broke curfew. I know who you are, but I do not wish to embarrass you. He did not call out the name of the four players. But looking over the whole room, he simply said, I don't embarrass you. So then he said, reported that he went back to the box at 3 o'clock, and in the box he found $700 in that box. And just as those guilty players, we need to recognize we have to feel remorseful, and we need to take steps toward repentance if we want to move beyond the effects of our sins. But we will never truly move beyond our burdens of sin until we see the mistake, until we admit the mistake, and until we accept the help of God, the only one that can remove the mistake. That's why in 1 John 1:9, God's word tells us, but if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from our wickedness. You know, beloved, our failures don't have to be final. They feel often final, but they don't have to be. But when we feel driven by our fears and failures, we need to be aware that not only God's forgiveness may feel like it's failed when we feel ashamed, but God's forgiveness may feel like it's failed if the effects of sin remain. When we see what our sin has caused, when we see someone that's hurt because of us, when we see the damage that's in a relationship, it's hard to even accept or even expect God will forgive us when the shame remains and the effect of the sin remains. I was telling you about the father who saw his children so ill, and how he went to the next village looking for a medical missionary to see if he could come and help with his children. He still knew the effects remained. Forgiveness was nowhere on his radar. But not only was it the fact that he had lost one child, but he felt paralyzed because this fear kept bringing itself up in his mind because he got word that his children were getting worse, and then he found out that other villagers in the village were getting sick, and many of the villagers were shunning his wife and his children. So no longer were they coming to check on them or help them, but they turned away from them, which means whatever killed the father's child did not die with the child. The pain and the suffering continued. So the fear and the blame and the shame still remained. And the father's feeling of guilt and grief would not cease. But then, in that same the one that did it. He's still there. Again, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were sinning, killing him on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But there's a big difference between wanting to forgive you and us accepting the forgiveness. In verse 8 and 10, it tells us in our text, oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. You would think that a God with that much power over guilt, that those who follow Jesus should not keep losing and living without joy. If God has a power and an open hand where we can just say, Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew the loyal spirit within me, you think just a wave of the hand that the joy would return. But the truth is, if we are not willing to seek the truth and see God's truth and accept God's truth, then our sins continue to show and the suffering continues to grow. That's why if you think about someone even in your own family where you all have had an argument, if all of a sudden the response is the silent treatment, things don't get better, things get worse. The more anger is shown and the more feelings, negative feelings, will grow. You see, we can't truly be cleansed of our guilt and grief if we keep staying focused on our grief and on our guilt. The truth is, if we want to proclaim and regain our joy, then we need to stop focusing and reflecting on our sin and start refocusing and reflecting our sin. That's how we do it. I remember seeing how, thinking about how our attitudes and actions, we fail to reflect what God wants us to do. That father and the other people in the village, for even after we've been helped by God, sometimes the physical and emotional pain remains, even after God's healing has been proclaimed. And it reminded me of a true situation, a tragic situation, where there was this man who was losing a limb. His doctor said the circulation is not there. The blood is not flowing. The color is changing. And he said, I believe we need to amputate the leg if we're going to save your life. And in that scenario that I was reading, it started to talk about how when that happens, when someone has a limb removed like a leg, often they suffer from what science simply calls phantom limb pain. Phantom limb pain occurs when the patient's brain acts as though the limb still exists. And the amputee may have the perception of an itch that he just can't scratch. They feel a pain that they just don't know how to soothe. Or you may feel your toes curling or even feeling a tremendous pain for a limb that no longer even exists. Well, Dr. Paul Brand was writing about his patient. Patient's name was Mr. Barwick. And Mr. Barwick was so obsessed with his pain. He was so obsessed with hating the pain and hating the leg that he told the doctor, when you cut this thing off, I don't want you to throw it away. I want you to put it in a jar and pickle it so I can keep it. And the doctor looked at him and said, have you lost your mind? He said, I want to take that leg and I want to put it on the shelf and in my wheelchair. I can roll up to the fireplace and look at it and say, all right, you see that? I cut you off and you can't hurt me anymore. That's what I want you to do, doctor. That's what I want you to do. But in his report, the doctor said, though he sought to humor his patient and even do what his patient asked, something took place. signs of sin still remains. And yet our text tells us we need to pray, oh Lord, give me back my joy again. Create in me a clean heart. Oh God, renew a loyal spirit within me. Beloved, if we don't want our failures to be final, then we must understand, we need to be aware and be aware that not only God's forgiveness may feel like it fails when we keep feeling ashamed, that God's forgiveness may feel like it fails if the sin, the effect of the sin remains, but God's forgiveness may feel like it's failed when God's love is not sustained. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But after he teaches us to say the Lord's Prayer, which we will be saying in just a moment in communion, as soon as Jesus finishes the Lord, what we call the Lord's Prayer, the very next two verses says, and if you go to God and ask for forgiveness, he will forgive you. But if those who have trespassed against you, if those who have walked all over you, if you will not forgive them, then God will not forgive them. In other words, God is devoted himself to play what I would call an eternal game of follow the leader. Because if I am the leader, you are to do whatever I do. And God is saying, I'm the leader. I have forgiven you, so you must now forgive others. But if we do not, God will say, okay, you lose. Tag, you're it. Now I'm going to do whatever you do. If you forgive, I will forgive. But if you don't forgive, then I won't forgive. I don't know about you, but I don't like that other game. I want to accept the forgiveness. And so I want to grant the forgiveness. But to do that, we must recognize and realize that third point. Not only will God, that God removes our remorse if we seek a new start, and God can cleanse and renew those with a guilty heart, but God can restore us to stop. God restores us to stop those who try to depart. He stops. Why does he heal me? He heals me to stop others. Anyone that tries to depart from him, he says, if I brought you back, now I need you to help go get others who are trying to pull away the way you did. That's why in our text, David prayed, oh Lord, restore to me the joy of your salvation and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach your ways to rebels, and they will return to you. In other words, Lord, as you come to me, I will go with them. As you have forgiven me, I will forgive them. And as you have brought me back, I will try to bring them back. In fact, Paul teaches us in Galatians 6:1, dear brothers and sisters, if another believer is overcome by some sin, you who are godly should gently and humbly help that person back onto the right path. And be careful not to fall into the same temptation yourself. There it is. Everything that we receive from God, we are to give back to God by giving to others. Or as Christ himself said, that which you do to the least of these, you don't do also unto me. That's why I love the words of the prayer of St. Francis of Assisi, who cried out, Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, let me show hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. Oh, divine master, grant that I will not just seek to be consoled as to console, or to be understood as to understand. could do. There's nothing they could do. Is there anything that you can do, that you will do? The missionary went with him back to the village and saw that it wasn't just that man's house, but it now was an epidemic throughout the village. And that young doctor did all that he could, all that he understood to heal him. But he never could figure out what was going on. That's what happens when we hide our sins. If we don't know what it is, we don't know what to do with it. And in his frustration, he pulled away, because not only was he a medical man, but he was a missionary, a man of God, and he went out of the village to pray. And while he was gone, he walked upstream, and he saw a warthog, concerned that it might come at him, but when he realized the warthog was depressed, still, whimpering even, with her nose in the water. And as he went closer, and he saw in the stream, where there was a curve, there were logs, there were debris, and there was a baby pig that belonged to the weeping mother. The mother, he could tell by the way the wood had been torn and pulled, she wanted to rescue that child, that young pig of hers, but she couldn't get to it, and he had died in the water. And he had been there so long that now his body was decaying, and the mother just stayed and watched. And he went out into the water to remove it and to bury it and to give some setup to stop it. But then he realized all the water that was running over that decay was being infected. And all that infected water was running down the stream to the village. And everyone that was there in the village, the children playing in the infected water. The clothing that was being washed in the infected water. The drinking that took place from the infected water. That's why they got ill. That's why they were dying. In the midst of the pain, he also saw the joy running back to the village saying, I know what was wrong. And now that I know what is wrong, I can heal you if you would just take